Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have 16th of March 2021, all right? And these classes are basically meant for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination as well as other government competitive examinations. And you require to answer the few questions related to the daily current affairs. Okay, so you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube where you will get these videos based on the current affairs on the day-to-day basis. All right, and you can supplement your preparation with the help of these videos, and simultaneously you can also study the national newspaper, right, like the Hindu and Indian Express. Both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer any of these newspapers. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so the first news is basically coming related to the post, or the post basically related to the professors in the central educational institutes and certain premier educational institutes like IITs and IIMs, right, are vacant, right? So the OVCs, other backward caste, then scheduled caste, SC, and scheduled tribe, ST, right? These categories of the candidates, their post have been reserved in IIMs, IITs, and other central educational institutions, right? So the education minister, Union Education Minister, basically replied in the Lok Sabha related to the vacancy positions of the OVCs, SC, and STs in those premier educational institutions. Okay, so according to the Union Education Minister, more than half of the faculty positions, okay, which are reserved for the OBCs or other backward classes in the central educational institutions, right, obviously of the higher education, are vacant. Okay, so this is basically the condition for the OBC. So more than 50% of the posts which are reserved for the OBCs are vacant in the central higher educational institution. Okay, for SC and ST, it is around 40% of those faculty positions which are reserved for SC and ST, they are remain unfilled. That means they are vacant. So for SC and for ST, it is more than 40% of those vacancies which are reserved for SC and ST have been vacant or not filled. Okay. Now, regarding the micro analysis, if you go through the Indian Institute of Management, which are the prestigious management institutions in India, okay, more than 60% of SC and OBCs, right, the seats specifically for the teaching post, okay, now have been vacant. So the teaching post, specifically the assistant professor, associate professor, and the professor's level, right, more than 60% of the positions which are reserved, okay, for SC and OBC have now been vacant. That means they have not been filled, okay, and this condition for the scheduled tribe is more acute, right? Around 80% of the positions which are reserved for them now have not been filled. That means these seats have been vacant. Okay. And if you compare, the total number of seats, out of 24 seats which are reserved for the scheduled tribe in the Indian Institute of Management, only 5 are filled. Only 5 seats are filled. Okay. Now, the IITs or Indian Institute of Technology, which are the premier institutions in India, right? These institutions have been provided only the data related to the non-faculty positions. That means the data have been provided for the non-teaching positions. The IITs have not been providing the data related to the teaching positions. Now, you should also understand that both IITs, right, and IIMs, both are basically lobbying for the exemption of, such faculty quota in their teaching post. Okay, that means both are basically asking the government of India, right, for not to implement the quota related or the reservation related provisions in those educational institutions, specifically the IITs and IIMs. So they are resisting such government move of giving the reservations specifically at the teaching level. Okay, if you compare, right, with the central universities, the vacancies are higher, specifically at the level of professors. Okay, because generally the professors, right, they are directly recruiting or from the assistant professor to the associate professor and then to the professor level. So this is how, you know, the in the basically in the hierarchy, the person move once he appointed as an assistant professor. Okay. If you compare the data from the central universities, all central universities, there are around 1,062 professors in all central universities, right? From the scheduled tribe community, only 1% of such 1,062 professors belongs to the scheduled tribe community. So the, you can consider that the scheduled tribe at the national level consisting of around 7.5%, but now only 1% of their representation is ensured at the professor's level. That means there are the huge vacancies, right? Specifically in the central universities also. Okay. Now, despite of these high levels of the vacancies, which are there in almost all educational institutions, premier educational institutions like IIMs, IITs, central universities, and other educational institutions. Okay. The Union Education Minister claimed that because of the implementation of the Central Educational Institution Reservation in the Teachers Cadre Act 2009, the OVC's reservation scenario have been implemented and have been improved a lot. But you can consider how, you know, you can see how the seats are remain vacant. Okay, despite of such statement which are given in the Lok Sabha. Okay, the next slide will give you the detailed breakup about the number of vacant positions, okay, for the OBC, SC, and STs, specifically in the central higher education institutions. Okay, now for example, I have given you the 79% of faculty positions which are reserved for the STs are vacant. Okay, so if you compare this, the 42 central universities which are there in India, the SCs vacancy is 39%, for the ST it is 42%, and for OBC it is 52% of the seats which are reserved for the OBCs now vacant. That means they are not filled. Then Sanskrit Central University is 12% of the SC seats or ST teaching post is vacant. 13% of the ST is vacant. 13% of the OBC is vacant. Then IGNU, 41% of the scheduled caste reserved post for the faculty positions are vacant, 49% vacancy in the case of ST and 67% vacancy in the case of OBC. Then for IITs, non-tech, non-faculty post, because IIT is not providing the faculty, the data, 36% of the post reserved for the non-faculty positions for SC, now they remain vacant, 47% vacant for ST and 42% vacant for OBC. For IIMs, 62% vacancy for SC, 79% vacancy for ST, and 63% vacancy for OBC. For IISERs, 39% vacancy for ST, 58% ST, and 44% for OBC. For IASC, right, the Indian Institute of Science, 20% vacancy for SC, 55% vacancy for ST, and 90% vacancy for the OBC. Overall, at the All India level, if you see, there are 38% vacancies for overall in the for the SC seats, 43% vacancy for ST, and 52% vacancy for OBC. So there are huge backlog in the post which are reserved for SC, ST, and OBCs. Okay. Next, the Government of National Capital Territory of Delhi Amendment Bill 2021. Okay. Now the Ministry of Home Affairs. Okay. Which is moved a bill specifically in the Lok Sabha, right, to declare or to propose that the Government of National Capital Territory, that means the current government which is led by Arvind Kejriwal, right, the government in the National Capital Territory meet the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi. That means very simple, the central government want that every decision taken by the government of Delhi or government of National Capital Territory of Delhi, right, should be screened through the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi. That means every such decision which is taken by the government of Delhi should be given compulsorily sanction by the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi. That means in other way you can say that the union government or the central government want that the Lieutenant Governor should be the supreme authority to decide on any issues related to the Delhi, right? And the lieutenant governor should have more discretionary power, right? It should, the bill want to give the lieutenant governor the discretionary power in every aspect in which the legislative assembly of Delhi or the government of Delhi has the power. That means every such bill or every such action which is taken by the Delhi government should be compulsory screened through the lieutenant governor of Delhi. So the Ministry of Home Affairs moved a bill in the Lok Sabha in which it proposed that the government in the national capital territory of Delhi means the lieutenant governor of Delhi. Okay. Now, obviously, the government or the Union Home Ministry want to amend, right, certain sections in the 1991 Act, which is also related to the National Capital Territory, Delhi. So it want to amend through this bill the section 21, section 24, 33 and 44 of the bill. If you consider the section 44 of 1991 Act, right, it says that every executive action, right, of the lieutenant governor, right, should be taken on the advice of the ministers or otherwise, okay, right, and such actions should be expressed to be taken in the name of lieutenant governor. That means the all executive actions which the government of Delhi is taking, right, they should be expressed to be taken in the name of lieutenant governor, okay, and all executive actions of the lieutenant governor should be taken on the advice of, you know, his ministers or otherwise. Okay. Next, the bill also gives the discretionary power to the lieutenant governor, even in the matter where the legislative assembly is empowered to make the laws. That means this clause very clearly says that the bill want the lieutenant governor a supreme authority in case of Delhi. Okay. So it want to give the lieutenant governor a more discretionary power. Discretionary power as those powers which are not, right, utilized by the lieutenant governor with the aid and advice of the council of ministers. That means the lieutenant governor by himself can take such step without taking the aid and advice from the council of ministers. So it want, or the, this will want, that the discretionary power given to the lieutenant governor should be broadened, and it should include also, right, all matters in which the legislative assembly of Delhi can also empower to make a law. Okay, the proposed legislation also seeks to ensure the lieutenant governor is a necessary granted an opportunity to give her opinion before any decision taken by the council of ministers which is being implemented. So that is what it want to make the lieutenant governor a supreme authority, and it want to ensure that whatever the decision that has to be taken or that is going to be implemented by the Council of Ministers or the Delhi government should be compulsorily, right, granted an opportunity to the lieutenant governor, right, that it should also, you know, screen such decision, right, before any such decision will be implemented. Okay. Next, the Great Indian Bustard. All you know that Great Indian Bustard is basically a state animal of Rajasthan. Sorry, it is a state bird of Rajasthan. Okay. Now, when you say the Great Indian Bustard, it is considered as a critically endangered, okay, in the red list. Okay. Now, their number is falling very fastly because of the anthropogenic regions, right? We have converted, right, their natural habitat into, you know, the different, the habitable zone. We have fragmented their habitation, which has led to the depleting of these numbers related to the Great Indian Bustard. Okay. Now, the Supreme Court of India intervened on behalf of this critically endangered Great Indian Bustard, okay, over their death, which is occurring, right, after, you know, getting collided with the power lines or high power lines. You have seen the high power tension cable lines, which is basically crossing, you know, the different states. So the Great Indian Bustard also collided with them, and they're dying in that process. Okay. So already their number is very low. Around 150 such birds are there. Okay. But their death, or their, you know, the unnatural death because of collision with such you know, power cables is also cause of the concern. Okay, their number is dwindling, specifically in the Gujarat and Rajasthan. That means these states are not taking enough steps to safeguard the population of Great Indian Bustard. The scientific name for the Great Indian Bustard is Ardeotis nigriceps. Okay, regarding how the Great Indian Bustard look, it has the black crown on the forehead. Okay, and it is contrasting with, you know, the pale neck and the head. And the body of the Great Indian Bustard is brownish. The wings is basically the black, brown, or it may be gray. Okay. The diet or what it feed upon, right? It consumes generally the grass seeds or sometimes insects like grasshoppers and the beetles. Sometimes the Great Indian Bustard also, you know, feed upon the rodents and the reptiles also. Okay. And regarding their distribution, that means where it is found, it is effectively, you must understand, currently in India, we have 150 such Great Indian Bustard is only left. And they are distributed in the five states of India. These five states are primarily Rajasthan and the Gujarat, where these birds are in the higher number, but they are also found in the Maharashtra, Karnataka, and Andhra Pradesh also. So they are primarily concentrated in the Rajasthan and the Gujarat, and the few population or small number of population also found in Maharashtra, Karnataka, and Andhra Pradesh also. The Great Indian Bustard is declared as the state bird of Rajasthan also. Okay. Regarding the habitat, as I told you that it is because of the fragmentation of that habitat, which is related to the Great Indian Bustard, okay, has led to the dwindling of their number and had led to, you know, the killing of such birds, okay, either by the naturally or unnaturally. Okay, now the bustard or Great Indian Bustard basically likes the flat open landscapes. Okay, they generally, okay, does not want any sort of a obstruction. That means they want a complete open stretch without any, you know, the scrubs like thickets or the taller grasses, even the forest areas. So they want basically the grasslands where, right, where the visual obstruction is minimal. Okay, so they are well adapted to the grasslands. Okay, they are well adapted to the grasslands, but because of the anthropogenic regions, these grasslands are also depleting. They are fragmented. So, and the Great Indian Bustard also avoid the grasses, and they also avoid sometime, you know, the dense scrub that is called thickets. Okay, regarding their conservation status, Government of India has included or has listed the Great Indian Bustard in the Schedule 1 of the Indian Wildlife Protection Act 1972. That means it has been accorded the highest level of protection under the Indian Wildlife Act 1972. It has been also listed in the Appendix 1 of the sites. Okay, and it has listed as a critically endangered species on the IUCN Red List. Okay, so it has been accorded the highest level of protection by the Government of India as well as the international level also. So you can see here the two Great Indian Bustard is talking, right? One is talking that, did you know that we are the state bird of Rajasthan, right? The second is saying, yes, we are the state bird of Rajasthan, but the state has neglecting us. Okay, next, the none of the above. So already you know that Supreme Court allowed the none of the above criteria or nota option for the electorates, that means for the voters. They can vote, okay, none of the candidates which are there in the fray. So they can just opt for the nota, that is none of the above. That means they are not willing to give their vote to the above candidates which are already there in the fray. Okay, now a petition was filed in the Honorable Supreme Court of India. Okay, that petition says that if the number of votes which is there in the nota option is more than, right, the candidate which is going to win, right, with the required vote, right, if the nota votes are more, right, the plea says that, or the petition says that there should be a fresh election. There should be a fresh election if the highest number of votes is basically being provided, right, to, you know, specifically, you know, to the nota option. So that is how, you know, the situation is, right? The petition also claimed that, right, if the nota option has the highest number of votes, okay, right, then such candidates which are there already in the fray should be debarred, right, or should not be allowed to contest the election, right, specifically, right, after the nota option is more. So this is what the petition. So Supreme Court of India asked the Center and the Election Commission of India, right, to respond related to the such plea, whether if the number of votes which is being given to the nota option is more than any of the candidate, whether the fresh election is needed or not. Okay, the second, whether such candidate, in the case of the nota option which are more, such candidates should be debarred from again fielding in the election. Okay, now the petitioner or the petition says that the rejected, once the candidates which are rejected by the voters should not be fielded against in the fresh polls. So that is what I was talking, that they should not be fielded in the fresh polls. Okay, the Chief Justice of India Sarad A. Bobde expressed the doubts initially about the feasibility of the petition, whether it would be feasible to entertain such petition, okay, whether to give the electorates or the voter, right, the right to reject. Okay, so right to reject is an option which is not there in India. Okay, and whether to entertain such plea or such petition to nudge the political party to present the voters with the better choice of the candidate to pick him. And obviously, if the electorates or the voters have the choice to reject or right to reject, the political parties will be compulsioned, right, to field only those candidates which are basically, you know, without any, you know, the tarnishing records. Okay, now the Justice Bobde also expressed his concern that if the voters or the electorates keep on rejecting the candidates in the case, okay, what will happen, right? The assembly seats or the parliament seats would remain vacant and there would be huge expenditure, and obviously that will affect the legislative functioning or the parliamentary functioning also. Okay, and the petition also argued that if the voters are given the power to reject, okay, now the political party will take care to field the worthy candidates in the first place. Obviously, if the nota option is provided, the political party will take care of fielding, right, only the worthy candidates in the elections. Okay, next, the arms import. That already, you know, the arms basically related to, you know, the arm race. Okay, where the countries are basically, you know, building their arsenals, right, in terms of the fighter aircraft, in terms of the missiles, in terms of, right, in terms of every sort of, you know, the arms, right? So the report which is given by the Swedish think tank, the Stockholm International Peace Research Institute, says that the arm import in the world has decreased by 33%. This data is compiled by the Stockholm International Peace Research Institute, says that between 2011 to 2015, this is the first period, and between 2016 to 2020, this is the second period. Okay, so between these two periods, okay, you know, the arm imports have decreased by 33%, right? But the report further says that the Saudi Arabia is the largest importer of the arms in the world, and India is the second largest importer of the arm in the world. Okay, regarding India's arm import, right, the India's arm import also recorded the drop in terms of the import between these two periods, between 2011 to 15 and 2016 to 20. So India also recorded a drop in the arm import. Okay, the reason given by the Stockholm International Peace Research Institute is that the procurement related procedure, right, of the arms import basically is complex and lengthy, which has led to the delay of the signing and the execution of such arm import related deals. Okay, and the other factor which is given by the Stockholm International Peace Research Institute is that the India also want to diversify its sources of the import related to the arm. That means previously the India was heavily dependent on the Russian, you know, arms. Now the India also want to diversify its imports or diversified source from there, from the India basically importing. So it started importing from the France, from the Israel, right, and started reducing their dependence on the Russian arms. So obviously by diversifying such import sources, okay, the ARM imports have significantly, you know, decreased in the two period. Okay, the Russia was the largest ARM supplier in the both of the years to India specifically. Okay, and the Russia's delivery to India dropped by 53% between these two periods, right? 2011 to 15 and 16 to 20. And the Russian supply to the India's import, or its share to the India's import, basically fell from 70% to 49%. So now the Russia share specifically in the Indian ARM import is basically 49%. Regarding, you know, the decrease of this Russia share, the France and the Israel have moved, right, in the position of providing the ARM export to India. So the France is the second largest ARM supplier to India. Okay, the Israel is third largest ARM supply between 2016 and 2020. We have purchased the Rafale from the French, right? And Israel also is supplying us with a lot of other, you know, arms also. So the ARM import from the France increased by 709%, right? And the ARM import from Israel rose by 82%. For India, the US is the largest or the fourth largest supplier of the arms in 2016 and 14. Okay, so obviously the largest supplier was Russia. Okay, then you have the France, then you have Israel, and you have US. The combat aircraft as well as the associated missiles made up of 50% of the arm import, which is led to the India. Okay, then Project Rehab. Rehab का मतलब होता है बेसिकली यहां पर द रिड्यूसिंग एलिफेंट राइट ह्यूमन अटैक यूजिंग बी. ऑलरेडी यू नो द बीज, हनी बीज, राइट? फ्रॉम यू नो वी कलेक्ट द हनी, राइट? सो द यू नो सो द खादी एंड द विलेज इंडस्ट्रियल कमीशन, विच इज यू नो अ गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया एंटरप्राइज. नाउ the Khadi and the Village Industrial Commission is basically launch a project where, you know, it has planned to install a bee box, okay, and at the periphery of any forest area, right, where there is a conflict between the human and animal, right, or there is a human animal conflict. So at that juncture, the honey bee box will be placed, okay. And there is the proven, you know, fact that the elephants, you know, fear from such honeybees. So they don't go very near to the honey box because they fear with the bees. So they just move away from the, you know, from the bee box. So the government of India or the Khadi and Village Industrial Commission is planning to, right, you know, to install the honey box or the bee boxes specifically at the border or at the periphery of the forest, where they can reduce the human and wildlife conflict, specifically, you know, the elephants which ventured out of the forest area, right, in search of the food or in search of, you know, the prey. So what will happen in the meanwhile, in the process, they also sometimes kill the humans, or they entered into the human habitation and they kill the humans. So to reduce this anthropogenic and the animal conflict, okay, the installing of the bee box along the periphery of the forest is the viable option as deduced by the Khadi and Village Industrial Commission, because the elephant is fearful of such bees. Okay, so a pilot project for such is already launched in the Kodagu district of Karnataka, where the Khadi and Village Industrial Commission all started installing the bee box along, you know, the periphery of the forest and the villages, right? And it is a belief that the villagers believe that, right, the elephant will not venture very close to the habitation once such bee box is installed, right? And the elephant will be avoiding the transgressing into the human habitations in that process, because elephants fear of such bees. Okay, so it is an initiative of the Khadi and Village Industrial Commission, right? And this project is Rehab, which is reducing elephant human attacks using the bee, right? Which is intent to create the bee fences. Fencing is something which is a protective cover, right? So it is consisting of the bee boxes, okay, to ultimately to thwart the attempt or by the elephant to attack on the human habitations using such honeybees. Okay, this pilot project was already launched in the 4 locations around the Chellur villages of the Kodagu district of the Karnataka by the Khadi and Village Industrial Commission. Okay, the spot which has been chosen for installing this, you know, the honey box or the bee box, basically in the Nagarhol, the national park, which is located in the Karnataka and the tiger reserve, right, which is a the major conflict zone between the human and animal. Okay, and this project rehab is a submission of the Khadi and Village Industrial Commission's National Honey Mission. Okay, if you see the number of casualties or number of fatalities related to the elephant, okay, between 2015 and 2020, 2,500 people lost their lives, right? Specifically when they have been attacked by the elephants, okay? 170 human fatalities have been reported in the Karnataka alone, okay? Right? You know, which has been provided by the Khadi and Village Industrial Commission, okay? Then the National Institute of Food Technology Entrepreneurship and the Management Bill 2019. Okay, now this bill is, you know, passed by the Rajya Sabha. So this bill is known as the National Institute of Food Technology Entrepreneurship and the Management Bill. Now, what is the purpose of this bill? This bill basically declared the certain or few educational institutions, right, which are providing the technical educational avenue for food technology entrepreneurship and the management, right? Only those educational institutions which will be declared at the institutions of the national importance. Okay. Now, there are 2 such institutions which are declared such institutions of the national importance. Okay. Such institutions are the National Institute of Food Technology Entrepreneurship and the Management, which is located in the Kundli in Haryana. And the second educational institution is Indian Institute of Food Processing Technology, which is currently located in the Thanjavur district of Tamil Nadu. Okay, and bill basically declared such institutions as the National Institute of Food Technology, right, entrepreneurship and management, which is of institutions of national importance. Okay, next, the Vara La Chala. Okay, so Vara La Chala is a pass, or it is a high altitude pass, which is located in the Himachal Pradesh. Now, during, the snowfall, this Vara La Chala pass basically, blocked during such snowfall, and the Leh and the Manali highways, basically, the movement or the traffic along Leh Manali highways basically snapped for the brief period of the time during such snowfall. Okay, so what happens is the Border Road Organization, which is the agency which is working at the border level to build the infrastructure in the border areas, started working of reopening of such the Vara La Chala pass, which was closed during such incidents in the Himachal Pradesh. Now, this move of the Border Road Organization would restore the connectivity to the Leh in the Ladakh, because the Vara La Chala, which is a pass or which is a high altitude pass, okay? So the Vara La Chala pass is basically located in the Himachal Pradesh. It is the high mountain pass located in the Jhanskar range. It is located in the Jhanskar range, okay, and which is connecting the Lahul district of the Himachal Pradesh, okay, to the Leh district of the Ladakh. So it connects the Lahul to the Leh, and it is located along the Leh Manali highway, okay. And this Vara La Chala pass is basically, act as a water divide. That means the two rivers, divided by this Vara La Chala pass between these two rivers are Bhaga River and your Yunam River. Okay, the Bhaga River is basically a tributary of Chenab River. Okay, and the Bhaga River basically originates from the Suryatal Lake. Okay, this is located a few kilometers away from the pass towards Manali, and that is the reason it is acting as the water divide between the Bhaga River and Yunam River. The Bhaga River is a tributary of Chenab River. Okay, you can see here how the pass is being closed sometime because of such, the snow. Okay, next, the Bhavna. Okay, so Bhavna is a traditional form of entertainment, which is famous in the Assam state. Okay, So it is having this religious significance of in the form of this entertainment. Okay. Now the pole bound state of the Assam is basically having, you know, almost all parties which are trying to garner the votes, right, by invoking certain, you know, other aspects. So the Congress in the Assam has tweaked the Bhavna, which is a traditional form of entertainment, for the political statement against, you know, the Citizenship Amendment Act and the National Register of the Citizen, which have been implemented in the Assam state. Okay, so Bhavna is a traditional form of entertainment, right? Which is basically, you know, some sort of religious messages, right, which are there in the state of Assam. The Bhavna is creation of the Shankar Deva, okay, which is a philosopher, right, written, this written in the 16th century. And the place of the Bhavna, which are popularly known as Ankiya Nuts, okay. Now, their staging is basically known as Bhavna, and Bhavna was written in the Assamese and Brajwali languages, which is a traditional art form of entertainment. So you can see here, the person is basically, bearing a mask, playing with the Bhavna. Okay, next, the Kunshi Raman Nayar. Okay, the full name is Guru Chemancheri Kunshi Raman Nayar. Right, he has recently died, right, at the age of 104, or at the age of 104. He was the recipient of the Padam Shri, okay, the Padam Shri Award. The Chenam Chemancheri Kunni Raman Nayar, which is also known as the Guru Chemancheri. He was born in 1916 and died in 2021 at the age of 104. He was the noted Indian Kathakali actor, okay, and he has great contribution to the classical Indian dance, specifically, you know, from the Kerala. And he has given the great contribution for making the Bharatanatyam as a popular form of, you know, dance in the northern Kerala. And he also established an institution called the Bharatiya Natya Kalyanam at Kannur district in the Kerala in 1945. And the Kunni Raman Nayar also established another school called Chelia Kathakli Vidyalam in 1983, specifically in the Chelia region. So he has given the greater contribution for popularizing the Bharatanatyam, right, as, you know, the Kathakli also as a classical Indian dance form from Kerala. Okay, so that's all for the today. So thank you very much. That's all for the today. We will meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you.